Now, in the previous lecture, what you have studied is what is material science and what is material engineering. Actually, today we are going to start with our first chapter, but before that, I think let us revise this quickly. What is this? So, basically, when we say material science, you know that we are exploring the principles. At the same time, when we say material engineering, so what we are doing is we are trying to use the principles of science to make something, right? That means engineering is everything about applying the principles of science. That is how these two are different. Now, as far as our course is concerned, we'll first try to understand the principles also, and then we'll also look at the properties of material, and with the help of that, we'll try to see that how to use the materials in our application, or which material should be used at which place. Right? So that is why the course name is Material Science and Engineering. Yes, discovery of alloys. Very good. So we'll say that we have seen one example of stainless steel. Right? So if before the discovery of stainless steel, there were so many problems in engineering applications because of corrosion, right? Now, as soon as this was found or this was discovered, all the problems were cope up. Now we can cope up with all the problems, right? All the problems were removed. So that is how discovery of new material can be revolutionary. One more example now see, understand that it's not only about discovery of new material. It's also about exploration of the use of existing materials. For example, aluminium was there, right? But now if we look at the manufacturing point of view, we can say that it was explored later that aluminium can be used in form of thin sheets for making different parts. So wherever or whenever we required less weight, low weight parts, we can use aluminium. Right? So that way, now always we'll think about two aspects. One is what are the properties, and second one is how to manufacture. It's not that, for example, currently you must be hearing this word composite material, right? Now this material is very useful, but the problem is its manufacturing. You cannot manufacture parts using the composites very easily. As we have standard manufacturing processes for metals like drilling or turning or milling, for composite materials we do not have such processes. So it's not that when we say we are looking for some materials, we'll always look at new discoveries. Okay, we will also try to improve the use or the methods how we can use the existing material for our application. So let's not discuss this thing in much detail, because in you have spent 1 hour in the previous lecture for this. So now let us go for today I wanted to show you what is our course website and what is the Moodle page, right? So we'll see Moodle page later. First we'll see the course website. So far I have not sent the link of this course website to you. So today I'm going to send you this. What you can do is you can go to your email and then you can go to the sites option over here. And if you click on the sites option, you will see this page, right? And here you can search the website which you are looking for. So this is one way of accessing the website. The second way of accessing the website is you just follow the link provided by the faculty member. So today I am going to provide this. So if once you open the website, you will see this page, and on the left side you will see introduction, academic year 2019-20, and then academic year 2020-21. So basically you will follow this 2021, and under that you will see A to Z of this course. You can see everything is there, right? So what is the course name and course code? What is the course syllabus? Everything is available on this website. So certain information would be like this, where you need to download it, and certain information is directly visible on the page like this. Here you don't need to download any information. But if you go to course syllabus, the course syllabus is uploaded. So you need to download that Word file, right? Similarly, all the information is available. Apart from that, if you see here, I have put exam papers, right? So you can access the previous examination exam papers over here. Of course, I have downloaded this from Nirma University Library website only. So you can directly go there and download it. But just to make your work easier, I have put the papers over here, and I will keep on updating this. So this is about course website of Material Science and Engineering. Now the second thing is the Moodle page. So today I will share this course with you. Once the course is shared with you, that means I have to enroll you. Once you are enrolled in this course, if you go to the Moodle page, you will see this course, Material Science and Engineering. So I'm taking a pause. Role number 4, can you reply? Are you able to see this Moodle page?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So this is the page. Now if we go to this page, I have uploaded some information. Like for example, this is the introduction of the course. Now on the same Moodle page, I have provided link to the course website. So that is the link of the same course website which I have shown to you. So you can access it through this Moodle page also. We will put more emphasis on Moodle because we are going to conduct the quizzes using the Moodle platform, as well as we will also conduct the assignment work using the Moodle. That means I will share the page, Moodle page, with you where you need to upload your assignment, right? So that is why you should check the Moodle page regularly for updates. Okay, so after the link to the course website, if you see, this is the first chapter of our course, and that is crystal structure. So I have already created a page for it, and I have put some animations over here for you, right? So far I have uploaded this information only. As today's lecture will be over, I may share some notes with you, and once the chapter is over, the PPT of the whole chapter will be shared on the Moodle platform. So is there any doubt regarding this Moodle page or course website? So the name of the chapter is Crystal Structure, and we will start with what is crystal structure. Now to understand that, first we need to understand what is space lattice, right? So there can be a 2D space lattice or a 3D space lattice. So if I consider that in this 2D space, there are certain points arranged in repetitive manner, let's say like this grid. Okay, So you can see these points are arranged in repetitive manner. Then I can say this is nothing but a 2D space lattice. Okay, this is a 2D space lattice. What should be the condition? The condition for defining this space lattice should be repetitiveness, right? So suppose I am saying that this is a unit distance, distance between these two points is a unit distance. Then the distance between this point and this point also must be same. So this also must be a unit distance, if this is a unit distance, right? Similarly, if I say this is a unit distance, then this also must be a unit distance, as well as this distance also must be unit, similar to this. Okay. So if this is 1 and this is 2, we will get that this distance is root 2. So throughout the grid, this distance should be root 2. Okay. This should be root 2, this should be root 2, this should be root 2. That means simply what we can say is, if I stand on any of the point, let's say I'm standing on this point, then the neighboring points would be at unit distance. This one also unit, this one also unit, this one also unit. Now if I change my place, okay, so rather than this, if I'm standing on this point where I have crossed, then also the neighboring points should be at the same distance. So that is nothing but a 2D space lattice. If we think about the same thing in 3D, okay, so let's say I have this type of arrangement. And the corners are representing the points over here. Okay, so this is a point, this is a point. All the corners are representing certain points. So now I am adding some more lines over here. Okay, so now in this structure, again we have to think the same way as we were thinking about a 2D space lattice. That means now if I stand on any of the point, let's say I am standing on this point over here where I have circled. So the distance of the neighboring point should be same as if I stand on this point where I have crossed. Okay. So we can say this is nothing but a 3D space lattice. This is a 3D space lattice. Okay. So now if we consider the attachment of atoms. Okay, so let's say we are now considering atomic arrangement. So in that case, if the atoms are situated at the lattice points, okay, so that means the points of the space lattice. See, these are the points of the space lattice. And let's say there is one atom situated at this point, one atom is situated at this point, and one atom is situated at this point. So we'll say these points are nothing but lattice points where atoms are situated. So now in case of atomic arrangement, if we find repetitiveness, then we can say that particular arrangement is crystalline arrangement. We will say it is crystalline arrangement. And the materials which are having this type of arrangement, they are known as crystalline materials. Right? So what are the examples? So we have examples like, let's say, aluminum. So aluminum is having FCC crystal structure. So it is a crystalline material. One more example is, let's say, iron. Iron is having BCC crystal structure. So that is also a crystalline material. So apart from this, do we have any other type of material? Okay, because we have defined that we have crystalline material. Do we have any other type of materials? Yes, we have. And those materials are known as non-crystalline materials. So now you must be understanding what should be the definition of non-crystalline materials. So non-crystalline materials are materials which are not having any specific atomic arrangement. Okay, so for example, if you look at the atomic arrangement of glass material, you will find that the atoms are not following any pattern. The atoms are arranged randomly. Everywhere you will see randomness. There will not be any repetitiveness. Okay, this type of structure you will see. No particular pattern is identified. So that is nothing but non-crystalline material. Okay, there are some semi-crystalline material as well. So for some part they may be following some crystalline arrangement, and for some part there is no specific arrangement of atoms. So like for example, this semiconductors, or let's say ceramics. Okay, so there may be some particular class of some material which may be having this semi-crystalline arrangement. Now, do we have any advantage of having crystalline arrangement in the material? If we compare these materials, crystalline material and semi-crystalline material, non-crystalline material, do we have any advantage of having crystalline materials? Yes. What are the advantages? In case of crystalline materials, we can define certain properties along certain directions. Okay, properties along directions we can define. So isn't it useful from application point of view? Because if you take a rod of aluminium or steel, and you know that along its axis, I'm talking about a circular bar. So along its axis, it is having this much of strength, right? So that is very useful in our application, in our engineering, right? So for crystalline material, it is possible to define properties along certain directions. Whereas for non-crystalline material, it is not possible because the atoms are not arranged along any pattern, or if they are not repeated. There are some more advantages of having crystalline material. Like for example, in case of crystalline material, we can define a specific melting point. Okay, we can define a precise melting point. Whereas in case of non-crystalline material, you may get a range of melting temperature. Okay, you may get a range of melting temperature. That means it may happen that if you are heating a glass, let's say you have a piece of glass and you are heating it, it may happen that it starts melting at certain point, a certain place, and at certain place still it is not melted. Okay, so it may happen. So that is because of the non-crystalline nature. So again, we have one more advantage of having crystalline arrangement. So there are certain advantages like this of crystalline materials. And our focus in this chapter would be on crystalline materials only. Okay, so that means we are not going to discuss about non-crystalline materials in this chapter. So now let's move ahead and let's try to understand crystal structures in detail. But if we want to understand these crystal structures in detail, then we have to understand certain terminology or certain terms. Okay. So first term which we need to understand is unit cell in crystal structure. So I am taking a pause over here just to give you some instruction that you may find some things repetitive here because you already have studied these things in your 12th. But we'll slowly come to the content which you are not knowing. But for that we have to discuss the basic things. So that is why we are starting with all these things. So let's go back to what we were discussing, and that is nothing but a unit cell. So rule number 5, if you have any idea about unit cell, you can define or you can just explain what it is. Do you have any idea about what is unit cell, rule number 5?
Yes sir.
Yeah, tell me.
So the cell which has one atom, maybe.
The cell which has one atom. Okay, partially.
Maybe it is called unit cell.
Okay, so you are in the same direction. But, okay. Rule number 6. Can you define? Do you know what is a unit cell? Rule number 6, are you there? Okay, I think he's not there. So, yes, let's define it. What is a unit cell? So, we'll take example of a 2D space lattice first. So, let's say this is a 2D space lattice. So in this 2D space lattice, let's say atoms are situated, all this is. Roll number 123, please mute yourself.
Sir, aapka echo aa raha hai.
Okay. Let me check. Now is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, yes, what I was telling is we are defining unit cell and we are looking at a 2D structure, right? Let's say we have a 2D structure over here and atoms are situated at all these places. So, now the definition of unit cell is it is a smallest possible cell, smallest cell which we can identify in the structure, in the crystal structure we should say, smallest cell in the structure by repeating which we will get the whole crystal structure. Okay, so if we take this example, then in this case, if we see this particular cell, okay, so the square which we can see over there, this one, this is nothing but a unit cell over here. Isn't it? So let me, yes, this is the unit cell over here. If you look at this carefully, if you consider this particular rectangle, this bigger rectangle, that is also repetitive. See, if you repeat this, still you are going to get the whole crystal structure, isn't it? But we are not defining that as unit cell, because we want the condition to be satisfied, and that is, it should be the smallest possible cell, right? So if you have your notebook and pen with you, you can note down this definition in your words. Also, during the lecture, if you find that you should note something, you should keep on noting it down. That may be helpful to you in preparing the upcoming assignments or quizzes. Okay. Yes, so this is the unit cell. Now let's see unit cell in 3D. Okay, so can you see this body centered cubic figure over here? Right, so this is the body centered cubic structure. This is the whole structure. So for this, what should be the unit cell?
Sir, isko slide sir.
Yeah.
इसको सर स्लाइड शो में दिखाओ ना तो थोड़ा बड़ा दिखेगा
ओके या ओके सो इफ यू कैन सी द यूनिट सेल इज ऑलरेडी शोन ओवर हियर इफ यू लुक एट द स्ट्रक्चर द होल स्ट्रक्चर लुक्स लाइक दिस Isn't it? So the thing is, we have to identify the smallest cell. So here we can see this is the smallest possible cell here. And that same cell is represented over here. If we repeat this, we will get the crystal structure. Now, why we are defining this? That is a question. Why should we define the unit cell? So can anyone answer? We'll go to roll number 10. Roll number 10, can you answer why should we define unit cell?
Yes sir, because it's a reference, it's like a reference structure for other other kinds of structure like BCC and FCC.
Okay, so why should we define it? Because if we define a unit cell, then we have to study a small cell only. Okay, so that means if I want to define certain properties, and if I define the properties for this particular unit cell, okay, I will define it for this only. Then also I will get the idea about the whole structure, isn't it? So don't you think that it is very helpful? Because to study the whole BCC crystal structure of a material and to study only a small cell, so second option would always be better, isn't it? So that is why we are defining unit cells. So that way, now by defining this unit cell, we will see, or by looking at the unit cells of different crystal structures, we will see that there are different types of crystal structure. So let's see now, what are these different crystal structures? So I will go back to the PPT. Okay, so the first structure. Okay, by the way, what we are doing is, now we are only concentrating on cubic structures. And cubic structure and one hexagonal structure, that is SC. Right? There are so many different types of crystal structures, which we will see later. But currently, we are focusing on only the cubic structure and the hexagonal structure. So here, if we look at the first cubic structure, that is nothing but body centered qubit. I am not making this full view because we are going to use the other mode. We will not use the PPT continuously. So if we look at the body centered qubit, the arrangement looks like this. Now can you see the unit cell is represented two way. Okay, here the first figure is also representing the unit cell, and the second figure, this is also representing a unit cell, and this is also representing a unit cell. What is the difference? The difference is, in the first figure, we are using the atoms, the representation of atoms as small size spheres. Whereas in the second representation, we are using a bigger size of spheres for representing the atoms. So this particular method of representing the atoms, it is known as reduced sphere method. This is called reduced sphere method of representing the atoms, and this is known as full sphere method or full sphere representation. Now why we should go for reduced sphere representation? Because you can see, when we look at the full sphere method, the atomic arrangement is not clearly visible. There may be some confusion. You can move to the third figure. Over there you will see that it is confusing, right? We cannot identify what is the pattern. But if we look at the reduced sphere method, we can clearly see the atoms, smaller spheres, and we can see how they are arranged. Okay. So now if we concentrate on the first figure, we can see that we have atoms at the corners of this cube, every corner of the cube, and we have one atom at the body center of the cube. And that is why the name is body centered qubit. Isn't it? So similarly, now if we go to the next figure, so that is again a cubic structure, right? So that figure is available now in front of you. Let me remove this annotation. Yeah, so this is nothing but space centered cubic. Again, if we look at the reduced sphere representation of this, we can see that we have atoms situated at all the corners of this cube, as well as now we have atoms available at all the face center of this cube. So this is a face center, this is also a face center, right? Similarly, these are the marked atoms, are the face centered atoms, right? And that is how, if we look at the full sphere representation, that is how the unit cell is. So if I make a cube here, you will see that this atom is at face center, this atom is at face center, this is at face center, this is also at face center, this is also at face center, and there should be one more at face center at the back side, right? And that is why the structure is named as face center qubit, FCC. In short, we call it FCC. Okay. Now, in case of FCC, you can see that these three atoms, I am concentrating on the top face, this particular atom, this particular atom, and this particular atom, these three atoms are touching each other. Okay, so if I show it in on the reduced sphere representation, I am drawing a line. So this particular atoms are touching each other always, right? So let's say if I say that the atomic radius is represented by a small r. Okay, atomic radius is represented by small r. In that case, what should be the length of this face diagonal? Let's say is f. So we'll say it is 4r, because these atoms are touching each other. So that we'll use now in the upcoming discussion. So this was about FCC, and the third structure which we are going to discuss in this chapter is, that is not cubic, right? So that is hexagonal structure. एंड द नेम इज हेक्सागोनल क्लोज पैक्ड स्ट्रक्चर. सो लेट्स अंडरस्टैंड हाउ द एटम्स आर अरेंज्ड इन दिस. इफ यू सी द रिड्यूस्ड स्फीयर रिप्रेजेंटेशन, वी हैव अ हेक्सागोनल प्रिज्म एंड वी हैव एटम्स अवेलेबल एट एवरी कॉर्नर ऑफ दिस हेक्सागोनल प्रिज्म. यू कैन सी एज वेल एज वी हैव वन एटम अवेलेबल एट द बेस सेंटर, ओके, बेस ऑफ द प्रिज्म. सो दैट इज वी कैन से फेस सेंटर ऑफ द प्रिज्म एंड वन एटम इज अवेलेबल एट द टॉप फेस सेंटर ऑफ दिस प्रिज्म, राइट. इफ आई डोंट कंसिडर दिस थ्री एटम्स विच आर अवेलेबल एट द middle of the cell, if I don't consider these three atoms, I would say that this structure is hexagonal, okay. I will not use this word close packed, I would say this is hexagonal structure. But if I use, if I consider these three atoms which are available at the middle of the cell, then that structure is known as hexagonal close packed structure. What is the meaning of close packed? So in this chapter, crystal structure, we'll use this word for the atomic arrangement where the atoms are touching each other. That means if all the atoms are touching each other, let's say in this case, if you see the full sphere representation, these three atoms which are at the middle, they are touching the top face also and they are touching the bottom face also. So that is a close packed arrangement. Right, so that is why it is known as hexagonal close packed. In case of FCC, if we see, we are not using any close packed word. Why? The reason is it is having close packed nature, but it is not a close packed nature of a whole body. Some face of the FCC can be close packed, right? So if we go back to FCC, in this case, if you see, the top face is close packed because all the atoms are touching each other, right? So that is how we are going to use this term close packed. We'll learn more about that in detail. Now, before moving further, let's go to our Moodle page and let me remove this annotation. So just to give you an idea about how it looks like in full sphere representation, I have made these animations, and these animations are available on the Moodle page. You can just have it, is just of some seconds, like 10 seconds or something like that. So this is BCC, right? So next, if we see, this is how FCC looks like in 3D view. Now you have to imagine always how it looks like in 3D, because when we'll discuss about certain terminology of crystal structure, that would be required. And if we go to the hexagonal close packed, it looks like this in 3D. Right? Okay. So this was the definition, or rather we should say introduction to the cubic cells, two cubic cells and one hexagonal cell which we are going to study. Now, as I was discussing some terminology, and one term we have already discussed, that is unit cell. Now, second term which we are going to discuss is coordination number. Coordination number. So, coordination number is nothing but it is number of atoms touching a single atom in the crystal structure. Or let's say we can always think about this by considering a unit cell also. Okay, that is the definition. Let's understand what it is. So if we look at the body centered cubic arrangement, right? So let's look at this figure. Okay, so if we see the body centered cubic arrangement, to get the coordination number, what we have to do? We have to focus on any one atom. So we can also look at this structure, or for our easiness, what we can do is we can consider the unit cell. So in unit cell now, if I consider the body centered atom, right, I have to just count how many atoms are touching this particular atom. Okay, so we'll see. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and the 8th one which is behind. So this is very easy in case of BCC, that 8 atoms are touching one particular atom. Now we have discussed this using unit cell, but if you go back to the whole structure and if you consider any one atom in the structure, this atom will be touched by 8 atoms always, right? But for that, what we have to do is we have to imagine in 3D, right? Because this is only a segment of the structure. This is continuous. Understand, this is still continuous. There are atoms available, or some more unit cells are available like this, right? So on this side also there is a unit cell. At the back also there is a unit cell. Now if we consider this particular atom, there will be one atom available over here, one atom available over here, one atom over here. That way, if we have to think. So coordination number will be same. No matter at which atom you are looking at in the structure, it will also always remain same. So what is the coordination number of BCC? So we can say coordination number of BCC is 8. Right. Now, how this is useful? This is useful because by looking at the coordination number, we will be able to understand how dense the atomic arrangement is within the structure. If it is 8, let's first discuss it for FCC now. Okay, we'll go to the next slide and we'll see what is coordination number for FCC. And then we will compare the coordination number of BCC and FCC both. Okay, so let's go to the next slide. So anyone from you, let's say I'm taking these roll numbers randomly. Okay, so there is nothing like I'm focusing on someone. So let's say roll number 20. Roll number 20, are you available?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, what is your name?
But Heth.
Heth, okay. Heth, can you tell me what is coordination number for FCC? Can you think about it? See, this is not a test or
just
something.
Just a minute, sir.
Yeah, this is not something like there is a test and I'm going to give you some mark. Okay, this is just to have some conversation. So any other you can
8.
Okay, Heath is saying that the coordination for FCC is 8. Any other student, you can raise your hand on the WebEx. You can raise your hand if you know.
Sir, we can't because we are not able to participate.
Right, so next time onwards I will make it enable. So right now let's go to roll number 90. Patel Josh. Are you available, Patel Josh? Josh, I cannot hear you. I think you have unmute yourself, but your voice is not. Okay. Let's go to roll number 86. Harshil. Yes, yes, Archil, you are audible. What is the coordination number of Fe2?
12, sir. 12.
Very good. Coordination number for FCC is 12. Okay, so you can mute yourself now. So those who are not understanding, let's see. If we consider this particular atom, what we have to see? How many atoms are touching this? So directly this atom is touching, this is also touching, this is also touching, and this is also touching. So four atoms are there. Now apart from that, we have these atoms. This would also be touching that atom. So there is 1, 2, 3, and fourth one would be at the back side somewhere over here. So these are 4 and 4 more. So that makes it 8 plus. Now, as I told you, we have to always imagine that the structure is continuous. So we have to imagine one more unit cell over here. If we imagine this unit cell, there would be 4 more face center atoms over here, which would be touching this atom. Okay, so we have added this 4 more, so 8 plus 4, so that gives us 12 atoms. So coordination number for FCC is 12. Right. So yeah, so this detailed discussion is useful for those who are not understanding. Let's go to the next structure, that is hexagonal close packed structure. It is very easy in case of hexagonal close packed. What we can do is we can easily consider the three atoms which are at the middle. The atom which is at the face center. If we consider this atom, right? So we can say these three atoms are touching it. So those are three atoms. Apart from that, these six atoms are touching that particular atom. So plus six. And as we have to think about one more unit cell which is on the upside of this. Okay, so there would be three more atoms. Okay, as we have these three atoms over here, similarly there would be three atoms over here. Okay, so those three atoms are also touching this atom. So plus three. So that gives us 12. Right, so coordination number for hexagonal close packed structure is 12.
Hello.
So as we have seen, yes.
Someone yes, is sir. Sir, like in face center, the middle one is situated at the center of the face. Okay. So yes. Similarly, HCP, these middle atoms, where are they situated?
Yeah. So they are situated at, you can see the reduced sphere representation. They are situated at the face center, hexagonal face center. I'm sorry. Can you see this now?
Yes. Sir.
So they are situated, this center atom which we have considered for coordination number calculation, that is this one.
Mm-hmm. No, sir, that the three in the middle, like below.
This three in the middle.
Yeah.
So these three in the middle are exactly at the middle of the height. Okay, so let's say if the height is C, we'll represent it by C. So these three atoms are situated at C by 2 height wise. Also, if we look at it from top, right? So let's say this is one atom. So this particular atom out of these three, that is situated at the center of this parallelogram from the top, if you see.
Okay.
So that way it is fixed. Height is fixed by C by 2 and the position is fixed by the center of the parallelogram.
Mm-hmm.
I hope that answers the question.
Okay, so thank you.
Yeah. So that was about hexagonal close packed structure. So let's go back to our whiteboard. And let me remove all these annotations. Yeah, so now onwards we have to remember this. That coordination number for FCC, VCC and HCC. So for BCC it is 8, for FCC it is 12, and for HCP also it is 12. Now we were comparing this, right? So by comparing this, we can see that FCC is having more dense arrangement of atoms as compared to BCC, and it looks like the dense arrangement in FCC and HCP is of same level. So is it true? Just think about, no need to answer it by unmuting your mic, just think about it. If the coordination number for FCC and HCP are same, can we say that the density of both are same? Yes. So in chat you are answering, the answer is no. Why? Because both are different. Because one is, FCC is a cubic structure, whereas this one is hexagonal, right? So dimensions of the cell are different. So overall size is different. So we cannot say that the density would be same. Okay, so we were about to take one more terminology, one more term, but we will not do that. Now we'll keep this discussion up to this, and the session is open for questions, but it would be better if you ask one by one, or if you write it in chat.